I've been working on the Nomad's Life project for about 2 years now. Despite having more than its fair share of challenges and trials, it's managed to keep hold of its original concept, which is to drive my old truck out to Mongolia to find the nomads and share in their ancient way of life. I got together with some friends and started to work to bring this idea to life. In the 5 weeks before leaving, we managed to secure a handful of sponsors, mostly private businesses and donations from friends. We each had our own reasons for wanting to go, but there was one essential chord that united us, which lay in the spirit of this whole adventure.
Right, Ramsay's maps. This is how Ramsay's going to find his way to Mongolia. That kind of maps, okay? So you can turn it whichever way you like. If the sun is that way, you turn it this way. You go this way. If the sun is over there, you turn it that way, you go over there. Easy. If the wind's blowing to your heart, you turn it upside down and you just stay right where you are. Every way leads to Mongolia.
We basically rebuilt the whole truck, modifying it to make it stronger and more practical. We begged, borrowed, or were given almost everything. A bunch of friends got together and helped with all the mechanics. We had to rebuild the whole exhaust system. We cut out the walkway from the rafters of an old warehouse and welded it together to make the rear platform. The whole inside of the truck was converted to accommodate 5 people for 6 months. It was looking so awesome, we decided to call it Genghis. I don't think anybody could quite believe that we were actually going to go. This crazy idea about driving an old army truck across 2 continents through some of the most harsh and remote parts of our planet was about to get underway. I guess we all had some reservations, and in the last moments, with all the rushing around, some stress too.
Hey, Mark.
Hi.
What are you doing at the moment?
I'm stressed with the insurance.
Why are you stressed?
Because they just want money. Just want to be insured.
Okay, and what do you have to get your insurance for?
The visa.
And how long you have to prepare to get your visa?
Very short time. Yes.
In days or weeks?
Minutes.
Minutes. So is it true you have about 20 minutes to arrange your insurance certificate so that you can get your Russian visa? Yeah. How long have you known about this?
On the 14th of June 2008, we finally pulled out of Amsterdam We were planning to drive through Germany, Poland, Belarus, and into Russia, below the Ural Mountains and into Siberia, above Kazakhstan and through into the Altai Mountains, then through to Shanta and into Mongolia. It was about a 10,000 kilometer drive to get there. A few people have remarked that this trip was also a nomadic journey. Well, the nomads moved for more practical reasons, survival of their livestock and the ecology of their environment. In many ways, we were in a more luxurious position. If there was any factor of moving for survival, I guess it would correspond to an inner call. Maybe survival is spirit, moving to stay loose and free, traveling to learn and gather knowledge from people who may not have strayed too far from their natural roots to understand where true spirit comes from. We were only a few hundred kilometers away from our starting point, and we were already facing the challenges of the road.
Last night, just as we rocked in, all the batteries went dead, the engine cut out. So, and then when we tried to charge both the batteries with the generator broke. So we spent about 2 hours trying to fix the generator. Realised that something on the solenoid had actually totally snapped off. So our new generator, which we got given actually the day before we left, is no good now. And we were lucky enough, Anna went up to the petrol station last night and used all of her lovely charm and persuaded the guy to let us charge both the batteries. So we're going to stick them back in now and see if we can get going, go to Poland. These are our two new batteries we bought yesterday at a place about 50 kilometers down the road. And these are our two old ones, which we thought were no good, but we've actually worked out that they're actually not so bad after all. They're both holding 12 volts each. And at the moment, the alternator, which they said was going to be fixed yesterday, looks like they've actually just got a new one. So we're all a little bit nervous at the moment about what the bill might be when we when they tell us how much it's going to cost. But hopefully after this we've devised a system which means that any of the overflow from the two new batteries can go into the two old batteries, and we can use those for recharging all the cameras and the computers and all of the other electrical things that we've got. So hopefully things are going to be good within the next hour. We'll be sorted.
Aside from all the mechanical problems, there were many other trials along the way, including just the tiredness of being on the road. Every now and again, we had to get out and have a good stretch. Prepare yourself for a long ride. Send me back to my chair, no serious sign. Let abuse our civil rights. And telling us what to do and how to live our lives. Who's to say what's wrong and right? So do what you want and what you like. Some seek solace in the night time. CCTV, Big Brother's eyes. And then there was the Russian police, who always showed a great interest in us whenever we saw them. One day, they pulled us over for a supposed speeding offence and charged us €150. We ended up giving them a broken DVD player as payment for it instead.
Flies are everywhere. I can't relax for a minute. I can't even look in my handbag for a minute. Just say, I need the hell out of me. I want a cigarette, I want the flies to go away, I want to go home, I want to wash my clothes, I want to have a shower.
You having a good time?
I'm having a tantrum.
We'd driven through Germany, Poland, Belarus, and we're now halfway through Russia. We were having to get used to doing everything in a different way. The roads had been getting progressively worse as we entered Siberia. Things were always rattling around and falling off shelves. We started off with about 20 drinking glasses and ended up with only 6. Even our back wheel nearly fell off in Omsk. Day by day, the scenery changed. Endless miles of tarmac, joining together all those places we'd read about, dreamed about, and planned to visit one day. Now made accessible by the unbridled passion the four of us had to get up and follow these roads. After 8,000 kilometers of driving, we began to leave the cities behind us. Coming into the Altai Mountains, everything became a lot more tranquil. But as the roads disappeared, the traveling became more intense. We eventually arrived in Koshigash, the last town of Siberia in the Altai Mountains, about 30 miles from the Mongolian border. The truck had already taken quite a beating with the deteriorating roads and was in much need of attention.
Can you make me a list of broken things?
Give you a list of things that aren't broken is much quicker. Yeah, you can see one of the bolts is completely snapped off. Inside, the other one's just gone. In fact, knows where that went. And also this, the hub seal, which is keeping all of the lubrication inside for the wheel when it's turning. So this oil, it's burst, the seal's burst inside. Hose is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There's seven. The big dilemma at the moment is the wheel. The guy's come and brought us this, which is totally broken anyway, but we can use these bolts, take them off, give them a bit of a good clean up. It just means taking this off, but at the moment we can't take it off because this bolt is totally broken as well. And I've got two mechanics now telling me that they can both do it. So we've just got potluck, choose the right one.
We didn't have the tools or spare parts needed to fix her, and it looked like we might just have reached the end of our trip. We chose a mechanic whose Russian name was too difficult to pronounce, so we affectionately named him John Smith. He amazingly helped us to fix virtually all of the problems with Genghis, and gave us all a newfound faith and confidence in our mission. We set off from Koshigash more than 80 kilometers off-road into the Altai Mountains in search of the Kazakh nomads who were said to be herding their animals there. It seemed ironic that we were searching for people who lived a much more simple life than we did, but their getting away from the modern world wasn't so easy at all. How is it that essentially we're all the same, but that the provenance of men can be so different? We got as far as we could with the truck, and it was time to go on by foot. It was Siberian summer now. Many wild and beautiful flowers were growing along the swift flowing rivers that ran from the icy mountain caps. It was around 17 to 18 degrees now, but in winter, temperatures would drop below 50 degrees centigrade. As beautiful and striking as we found it, we wondered how it could be home to people too.
You're looking for nomads?
After much walking, we spotted the first livestock, a herd of goats grazing close by to a felt gare and a wooden corral. We approached and were welcomed by the head of a family of Kazakh nomads. Cookbook was 90 years old and still living her life in a traditional nomadic way. We asked her and her family lots of questions about the valley, their animals, family and their way of life. They had 600 yak, 300 sheep and goats, 40 cows and 60 horses. A tally that made them very wealthy by nomadic standards. Yet they still chose to live this simplistic existence in a very modest home, far away from the wonders of the modern world. In older times, they would have moved many hundreds of kilometers every year with their animals into Kazakhstan and back. Cookbook said that now there was no motive for traveling so far. This was their summer grazing grounds. In autumn, the children would go to school 80 kilometers away down the valley, where they had a corral at a lower elevation. There they would spend the winters where it was less cold. They repeated this structure every year, moving out to the valley each spring, making their way of life semi-nomadic, a term now more commonly used throughout these regions of Siberia, since the Russian state demanded a permanent address from all of their citizens. At the entrance of their valley stood a large grassy sloped hill where paintings and hieroglyphs were scratched into the surfaces by nomadic tribesmen. It was a holy place for nomads for as far back as history could tell. The shamans of the nomadic tribes would come here to communicate with nature and ask for certain blessings from the mountains for the well-being of their kinsmen and livestock. The precious stories that the nomads kept here throughout the ages still held together their own worldview. A connection with their environment, with all nature that surrounded them, was honored and seen as undivided, each a part of the whole that could communicate with each other throughout the rituals they performed, reminding their legacies of what is sacred, with inscriptions into rock that would outlive even their great-great-grandchildren. Cookbook had lived a whole life in this valley, which we later found out was called Talbuash. Translated, this means Valley of the Goddess. Still living her life caring for her family, Cookbook was truly the goddess of this place. Coming through the border into Mongolia was a huge landmark for us. We travelled 10,000 kilometres and it felt like crossing over the last frontier. Most of the guards were okay, and one of them even celebrated our arrival with us. But not all of the officials were so friendly.
Hey.
200 meters on the other side of the border, and there was a series of squiggles winding their way up into the hills ahead of us. These were our new roads, signs left from the previous vehicles that had navigated their way as best as they could over the rocks and crags to where it is they were going. Even though there is an increase of motor vehicles being used in Mongolia, the preferred mode of transport is still a horse or a camel. Some of the nomads ride yaks, and in one of the most remote regions, they can still be seen to ride reindeer. We soon found out that maps were of little use. The only trustable methods of navigation were to stop other infrequent travelers and ask them to point you in the right direction. We were left to find our own way as best we could. This was our initiation into the vast warmth and generosity of the Mongolian people, who seemed ever ready to help a fellow traveller. It's amazing that in such a vast, open, wild and unfenced land, we were hardly ever made to feel like strangers. Before we headed into the remote parts of Mongolia, we wanted to make sure we had all the right supplies we would need. Going through one of the ramshackle town markets was a testimony to the ability of nomads to make whatever they need from whatever is available. When the nomads come into the towns, it's either to trade in the markets or to stock up on things they just don't find out on the steppe. For a few Mongolian tugrug, you can even get your fortune told by a local shaman. There were endless stores of second and third and fourth hand spare parts from just about any machinery you could think of. A few more mechanical missions, and we headed out to find the Kazakhs. The road since leaving Europe got gradually worse the further east we came. If we thought that the passage through Siberia and the Altai was difficult, it was nothing compared to the terrain we were now traversing. We were being faced with one navigational feat after another, and again, it was only through asking the nomads that we managed to find our way. Mongolia is about six times as big as Britain, yet it only has about 750 miles of paved road. The rest is a vast, wild, unfenced land that stretches for weeks on end beyond the horizon in every direction. When you do come to a halt, it's more often than not that a family of nomads has beckoned you in to share their warmth and hospitality.
Oh. he now know 100 songs, like Kazakh songs.
Bye! Bye-bye!
Kazakhs have retained a strong folklore and cultural heritage. One of the Kazakh traditions is hunting with an eagle. Unrik has been training and hunting with his eagle for nearly 4 years now. This is his third bird, the first already returned to the wild after a 10-year period spent together hunting with Unrik. The eagle is given a new name for each of her first 10 years. When the eagle is 10 years old, it is freed again. The eagle hunter climbs to the top of a mountain with a dead sheep and leaves it there as a present for the eagle. This is the parting gift. Unrik says that the eagle is sad to leave her master, and often she comes back to her master's house. But they must part again, and this makes the master sad, for they have been companions for 10 years. The eagle used for hunting is always female, which is bigger, stronger, and a better hunter than the male. When the eagle is 10 years old, she becomes broody and wants to have young of her own, so she must be set free. The eagle knows this because it is her nature, but still it is hard to part. Unrik tells that his first bird came back to him 10 years after parting. He was happy to see her, but they had to part once again, and she flew away one last time. Eagles are kings of the sky. Between eagles and men, it is a sacred friendship. In the summer, the eagles eat and sleep. They do not hunt in summer. Summer is for resting and getting fat. In summer, food is plentiful, and it is time for getting stronger. In winter it is different. In winter food is scarce and animals are skinny. This is when the nomads need the meat that the eagles hunt for them. They use the furs to make warm clothes to protect them from the cold. When Enrique was a child, his uncle taught him eagle hunting. He went with his uncle on hunts and watched. At 20 years old, he climbed to the top of a mountain and took his first baby eagle from a nest. Then Enrique taught the eagle how to fly, because it had no mother anymore to teach it. Some hunters train their birds by tying them to a pole so that they fall when they try to fly. After some time, they learn not to fly away. Enrique used this method with his first bird, but now he trains the eagle not to fly away by not giving it water for a long time before a hunt. This way, the bird comes back because she is thirsty. Enrique trains the bird to catch skins when it is little, then as it grows older, with small animals in an enclosure. When she is 4 years old, she is ready to hunt. When the eagle catches an animal, she does not kill it. She brings it to her master and he kills it, always sharing the meat with the bird. Watching Henri ride alongside us through the barren valley, it is easy to imagine what fear and respect his forebears would have provoked in our ancestors' hearts. Riding high on his stirrups with his eagle perched on his arm, unfaltering in the heavy noon heat, in spite of his rich and ornate clothing. He looked the living incarnation of a prince, strong, impressive, and proud. The Kazakh understood that survival came from movement, that riding a horse as opposed to eating it provides many more opportunities for hunting, of conquest, of growth and survival. And the Kazakh conquered the land. Then the Kazakh saw that if men are slow, if their vision is limited, if they can only hunt with a knife or a bow or a club, because what is man's bare hands? The eagle is fast, sees further, is completely designed for its purpose, to hunt. The Kazakh made an ally of the eagle, and he conquered the sky. Kazakhs say, we are the children of the sun and freedom, of open spaces. We once knew how to fly. Now we ride our horses across the steppes as fast as the wind. After a few days of driving, we came across a Kazakh family who were just moving into their summer grazing grounds and setting up their camp.
The
rope that they're binding now, they're using to tie the horizontal beams that they use for the roof on the yurt. One end is actually tapered off and goes into the ring at the top, and the other end, which is bent and attached to the walls, they tie with this rope. And the rope's made from the hair from the yak, and most of it actually comes from the tail end of the yak, where the hair is the longest. And this is how they bind it together.
Bayırlı.
No problem. Yeah, you can see everything in this yurt, their home, they completely make themselves. It's the cross beams of the walls. You just make a hole through each one, each section. And then they take a little bit of leather of the animal skin, poke it through, make a knot, and it's tied together. So no nails, no screws, no complicated hinges. Just a little piece of leather through a hole. Most of us in the modern world don't know how to build our own houses anymore. We've forgotten what it means to live and work together as a family unit. Providing for ourselves and our loved ones has taken on a different meaning. It seems like we are moving away from nature. The basic survivor skills, which in another time would have been taught to us by our fathers and their fathers before them, has been replaced with a system that is dependent on a socio-economic state. We have houses built for us,
when our pay packet allows it. Nomadic life is by no means a romantic existence. On the contrary, it is a hard and practical lifestyle that needs guts and stamina to sustain itself. Yet to watch how this family worked between themselves and with their environment seemed effortless. It was synergy in action. This family unit would move their home at least four times each year, depending on the seasons. It was starting to get late into the summer now, and we still had a long way to go to find the Tsatan, a tribe of nomads living in teepees who herded reindeer in the most inaccessible part of Mongolia, the Darkhad Depression. If we were to find these people, we had to make our way soon to get there before the winter set in. Darkhad Depression is one of the most difficult to reach inhabited places of this world. We got as far as we could with the truck. The last few days spending 12 hours each day behind the wheel to complete at most 100 kilometers per day. We stopped just outside Sagan Noor, a small town just about as far away from anywhere as a town could get, and went to find some horses and a guide. We met a Mongolian Malchin called Ganja. who's then spent the next 2 weeks with us on horseback, travelling over the mountain ridge to look for where the Satan people lived. In this time with Ganja, we got to see and experience just how incredibly at home and at one the nomads are with their environment. Ganja, sitting astride his sturdy steppe pony, seemed every bit as part of the scenery as the streams, forest, rocks and mountains did. He was more than keen to share everything he knew. After the fourth day riding, we came across a clearing in the forest by a river with four teepees, wafts of smoke drifting up from their tops. We made our camp just outside and waited to be invited in. Our first encounter was, in fact, with some of their yaks that were being used to haul logs into their camp, but we had to wait until the following morning before we were visited by two Satan women and a small child. After some getting to know each other, we were invited over to their camp and introduced to the other members of their family.
Hetsun chetsul baakhar da tsaagaal da magdunna da yamar chigul baasan. Odo en taa hodoch buu taas baakhar tsaat taa nangoodaran tuulaad Төрөөс харахнаар тэгээр өнгөрсөн байна даа харахгүй шүү.
Өнгөрсөн аа.
Яг энэ цагтаа гэж юм байна.
Байхгүй шүү.
Манай яг л цагаан нураас л ирэв.
Тайгандаа байхгүй.
Тавдаа л. Жижиг аа энэ дөндөөс ирэв.
Миний хүүд ч гэдэг юм дараа сургууль явсан. Би бол 14 тий.
Аа за.
Байна. Би бол хүүхдээ дийлэгтэй тэгтэй гэж ярина. Тийм байсан юм байсан гэж ярина.
Аа.
Цаа бол одоо чи одоо миний ундаж ядлж явсна цаана чанар болоод би бол багдсан.
Аа
цаавал догж өгдөг болсон байдаг. Цээж өгдсөн болсон байдаг.
Тийм үү?
Нэ.
Дээр үгүй.
Дээр миний үйд бол одоо яа цаад гэж өгдөг гэл байсан юм да. Эхдээ цус ойртдаг болоо ихэнэ. Яагаад тийм бол цааны цаа өгдөг. Цаа биеийн ерэн багддаг.
Этраса.
Этраса болдог болоо.
She wished to have, you know, to see the world. I mean, she's blind, right? Yeah. Her only wish is to, able to see the world, the things, yeah.
Autumn.
By its lag, it is.
Some people said that we should have left the nomads alone, that any contact is just a furthering pollution to an ancient and traditional, sustainable way of life. While the modern world is advancing all the time, pressuring the older cultures into an inevitable relationship, we came to see and hear for ourselves what their side of the relationship had to say. Leaving behind this magical realm, somehow forgotten for the most part by the urges of time, was like drifting away from a colourful and vivid dream. The nomads here, the true princes of the steppes, belong to no party or set of ideas. They belong to themselves and to the land. They belong to their families and their livestock, to the life and environment that gave rise to all the props in their lives. It's true, we only got a glimpse of this way of life, of this phenomena of existence. Yet this touch took a bearing to something deeper inside of oneself than the perimeters of what is called a civilized existence. As we headed north out of Ulaanbaatar and towards the Siberian border, it seemed as if there was something very real being left behind. Real in the terms that most of these peoples knew and understood most of the sequences, how each of the things in their life came into being. And for the most part, they were an integral mechanism in its coming about. Their clothes, homes, food, transport was born from the land and animals in their care and shaped with their own hands into the tools of surviving here where they knew how to. Albeit hard work to receive it, this land gave everything necessary for them to live and thrive. We crossed the border out of Mongolia and back into Siberia. Tracks across the unfenced land were once more exchanged for tarmac roads. We were faced with maybe more than our fair share of challenges on the way home, including having to repair a broken drive shaft, a seized gear in the rear axle, and a 3-day wait at the border due to arriving some hours later than our permitted 12-day stay. Each of the obstacles we overcome, somewhat miraculously, as we were sent what seemed to us like angels of the road who helped us on our way. For some reason, this journey was meant to make a full circle.
Allah, 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 All